Welcome to Sober Smash. Sober Smash. Get to the core issues with King Scott and Dr. Joe and get Sober Smashed.
Welcome to another edition of Sober Smash Live. Our special guest today is Jill Stellacio. She's an addiction counselor working right down here in South Florida. She's from the great state of Jersey. Now let's turn it over to our host, the smartest man in podcast. It's King Scott and Dr. Joe.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to the show. Jill, welcome. Nice to meet you.
Thank
Dr.
you.
Joe. Happy Tuesday afternoon.
Yes, Scott.
As usual. In beautiful South Florida. Jill, we're excited to talk to you today. We heard a lot about you, a lot of energy, all good stuff. And you are from Jersey.
I am from New Jersey.
So am I.
South Jersey.
Well, I don't know about South Jersey, but Jersey's good.
You're North Jersey.
I'm North Jersey,
We talked about this a little bit, yes.
Right, right.
Yeah. Philadelphia, New York, basically.
New York here.
There you go.
New York
you
in the
are
house.
Better than me, yes. I will. I will admit it. I've always wanted to be from New York, but I'm not.
There you go.
New York envy.
Yeah.
So how long have you been in the industry?
So been in the addiction field for about 8 years now. Came down to South Florida to, you know, get treatment for myself, for my own problem with addiction about nine and a half years ago, okay? And I started in the field right away just after my experience in treatment. I was that, I guess, ambitious and overzealous, if you will, that I thought, oh, God, I love this. I love the therapy. I love everything about this energy and helping other people. I saw some amazing things happening in treatment, and I wanted to do it.
Yeah. It's very rewarding.
It is.
As we know every day, we basically are in the business of saving lives.
Yeah.
That's what we do.
Yeah, exactly. What's better than that?
Nothing.
You know?
That's
I mean,
it.
Some days I come home, and I have to say, I'm sure it happens to you guys, too. It's very emotional. You know, it really weighs on you a lot. I have some days where, you know, I'm laughing because I'm so happy that maybe, you know, you made some movement with somebody. It's like the greatest feeling in the world.
Sure.
And then maybe you lose somebody,
right,
you know.
Yes.
So it's always that balance of just tragedy and just amazing happiness, you know, going through us all the time. It really takes a special breed to be able to do what we do.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, with the heroin epidemic, unfortunately, we're losing a lot of young people.
Oh, God.
And it's so sad that now
awful.
More than ever, we need addiction treatment.
Oh, yes. Yes. And now more than ever, unfortunately, the insurance companies are really giving us a hard time in doing that and,
yes.
and giving people the long-term care that they need. You know, I was really blessed with a mother that, you know, was a teacher at a high school in New Jersey. And she was, you know, she had that Aetna policy that everybody had, you know, 9 years ago. And substance abuse was covered for months at a time. And they paid residential for months at a time.
Yes.
So I was very fortunate that I got that opportunity that not a lot of people are getting now. You know, it's very sad.
Yeah. Could you talk a little bit about your treatment experience for that? We have listeners out there that may be curious, interested. Maybe they know they need some treatment, but they are not sure what to do and where to go.
Yeah.
How was your experience?
So my experience was in treatment was actually, I mean, I have to say, probably the greatest time of my life. And that includes all of my partying days, all of my college days, my entire life. I finally got to a place where I felt like I belonged. You know, when I walked up to that detox facility, the tech came up to me, I'll never forget, and she had open arms. I didn't know this woman. And she said, "Welcome." And I lost it. I was so emotional. And I just kind of thought to myself, this is it. Like, this is the beginning and of a new life, you know. And I got to meet a lot of great people. And I also saw a lot of what the disease can do to you if you're not able to, you know, really grasp the program right away, right? We had a lot of people in and out and things like this. But I had this healthy fear. I never wanted to go through it again. At the same time, it was probably the most whole I had ever felt up until that point.
Also, I want to remind the audience, if anyone has any questions for either myself, Dr. Joe, or Jill, please write in or phone in, and we'll make sure we get your questions answered.
How were you in the beginning of treatment taking direction from professionals? Because some of the challenges we have in working in this field is that our clients don't often take our suggestions. Mm. And it's very frustrating because we know what may really help them, and unfortunately they don't choose to follow our direction. So how was that for you?
In my treatment experience, I will say that I think it's just natural for an addict to rebel and to defy. And I am not any different from that. When I was in treatment, I played the cutesy girl. I was the cute girl. I was like 120 at the time and striking at the time. Food has become my new addiction. But, you know, I rebelled as well, you know. Of course, I was looking at some guy on the other side of the, you know, group room, you know. We all do that stuff. So I think it really just depends on, you have to kind of go with the resistance, you know, in the beginning. They're not going to listen to you at first. Addicts kind of have to learn their own way is what I find. Sure. So what I try to do is just say, listen, I've done it. I get it. It's not going to work out. But I'm just letting you know, we discussed it, okay? When you're ready to stop beating your head up against the wall, you let me know.
Yes.
Right?
Beautiful.
Yeah.
Well, it's always that sense of, you know, uncertainty when you walk through that door.
Yeah.
And we know it here at Treatment Partners. When somebody walks through that door, we want to make them feel at home.
Sure.
Yes. And that's a big step to take.
Huge.
As soon as that door opens and you step in, that's the first step to your new life.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And it could go either way. If you have an angry tech or a therapist having a bad day, right? Yes. I'm having some...
We don't have any of that at Treatment Partners. Never.
We sure hope not.
Never.
Right. Yeah. Right. Yeah, you really need to be taking care of yourself and watch
this
what you're
a happy,
saying.
This is a happy place.
Happy place, there's no doubt.
Happy
Happy, happy. Yes, and I see that. Yeah. Yes. So, you know, but that's exactly that type of environment is going to keep them in the seat, right? So, you know, what you say to them and being compassionate and being empathetic is, if that's going to keep them in the seat one more day, that's what you got to do, right? Yeah.
What do you see in your practice, you traveling around, the biggest addiction right now currently?
Biggest addiction right now currently. Oh, boy. Well, I'm seeing a lot of, I mean, now you're talking about like drug-wise?
Drug-wise, yeah.
Heroin, of course, is always huge, but I'm also seeing a lot of meth, and which is very scary because the effects that it has, I mean, hey, listen, every drug has a very bad effect on the brain and our chemistry and our behavior. But the meth use that I'm seeing is much more than I have seen in the past, you know, couple of years since I've been in recovery. And been in the business. So that is very scary. You know, these clients that I see coming in are very altered and not behaviorally even able to settle down and to land for quite some time. So really keeping them in the seat is quite a challenge, you know. So we're always looking for different ways to kind of speak to them so that they'll stay put, you know.
Sure. Yeah.
So I'm seeing a lot of that.
Yes, meth, you know, meth was a drug known for being out in California and the West. Then it moved to the Midwest. Then it moved to Tennessee and Arkansas. And we, for many years, never saw much meth down south. But I think the train's coming in.
Oh,
and I think people are starting to use it down here.
It's arrived.
And it is, like you said, it burns out nerve cells. And people are, they're like ADD when they're off of meth. Because their nerve endings and everything is just so irritated still, and it's quite a challenge working with those clients. So
it
I understand what
is.
You mean by that. Sure.
Do you see, Jill? Do you see the future of just the way you approach a client with, you know, from a therapy standpoint, changing? Where it was, let's say, 4 or 5 years ago?
Oh, absolutely. I remember when I had first started as a therapist, it seemed that the clientele that I was seeing was much more open, much more motivated, much more willing to get the treatment that was needed. But I'm noticing nowadays a little bit of a detachment or a disconnect in some clients. And I don't know if you noticed this as well. And I really am a strong believer that our technology strategy in the world today is desensitizing our children and desensitizing generations that are coming to treatment now. There is a social development problem here that I'm finding, and you know, it's not like it used to be. I'll go to dinner with my boyfriend and I'll see these kids on iPads and things like this, not having conversations like we once did when we were younger.
What do you think causes this aside from the social media?
Causes the disconnect?
Disconnect, yeah.
It could be a multitude of things, not just social media, but also, just technology, just a lack in maybe some parenting skills. That's really the number one thing. I mean, it is kind of the parent allowing that to happen, right? So it's really important that parents know that, if your child does not develop socially, if they're not outside playing, that's what I used to do. I'm the child before the technology and after the technology, right? I used to play outdoors and be able to play games and interact socially with other kids. And I really think that has a lot to do with my success today.
Yes, I think with electronic media, I mean, it's part of the society we are currently in. But I think also with both parents working nowadays, with the income needed to live the lifestyles we live, I think it's so easy to give a 2 or 3 year old an iPad and they will sit for hours and hours absorbed in that while mom makes dinner or whatever. And the reality is they're growing up by themselves with electronics.
It's called iPad addiction.
There's another one.
You go to any restaurant, you can look over tables of families, everyone has it.
Yeah. Right. Right, exactly.
My kids are guilty.
Yeah.
My own family.
So we do treat that here at Treatment Parts of America. If you have an addiction to your iPad, we will bring you in here and treat you for that.
Absolutely. For sure.
And I got to tell you, I mean, I'm one of those. I'm addicted to it, too. I can't put my phone down. So I'm being quite a hypocrite just talking about it right now, but it is,
right, yeah.
It's constant.
So I think it's a combination of the lifestyle we live now, the hurry-up lifestyle, and also electronics are a good thing in many places, so it's not all bad.
Hey, I would never get here without the GPS. I would have never found it.
Exactly.
Right? So, Jill, what would you say to that 20-year-old that's out there listening right now saying, you know what? I think I have some issues. Mm-hmm. I don't know what to do right now.
I would say there are people that understand you that you don't even know exist. If you just pick up that phone, even though that phone may feel like 1,000 pounds, once you get the words out and once you ask for help, you will be hit with so much support and so much empathy and so much compassion. Really so much that you've never really experienced before. There are other people like you. I am one of them, and I've met thousands of others, and we are here to help you. That's our purpose. So call.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
And also family members that are going through this.
Yeah.
That have a loved one, and they're really looking for some sort of support or guidance to do.
Sure. Al-Anon, 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 Naranon, Naranon, Naranon.
Here, here, here.
Buy the Boundaries book by Townsend and Cloud. Buy Codependent No More. Set those boundaries. Please follow the recommendations that are being given by the staff of whatever facility your loved one is in. This has everything to do with family. If the family is not doing their work, I have a colleague that says all the time it's a parallel process. If the family members are not doing the work, the loved one has a very, very, well, their chances of success decrease. So it is just as important for a parent to do their own work and understand that there's a difference between enabling and support.
Right.
Absolutely.
And much of the advice you'll get from clinical staff may very well go against your maternal or paternal instincts.
You got it.
But I'm going to ask you to trust the professionals.
Yes.
What you think is going to help is actually going to continue to hurt your loved one.
Yes.
All right. We're going to take a short break and we'll be right back. Stand by.
Welcome to Treatment Partners of America, your partner in recovery. Treatment Partners of America is a unique, state-of-the-art substance abuse facility. Our trained professionals first focus on finding the core issues in trauma that lead to addiction. With some of the best doctors, nurses, and behavioral health techs the industry has to offer. We offer personalized one-on-one therapy 5 days a week, raising the bar to a higher level of standards. Whether it's drugs, alcohol, eating disorders, gambling, sex and love addiction, or even relationship addiction, Treatment Partners of America has specialists to treat and to help heal your addiction long-term rather than attempt a temporary 30-day quick fix.
And we're back with more Sober Smash Live with King Scott and Dr. Joe and our special guest, Jill Stellacio.
Thank you, Pardo. We appreciate that introduction.
You're welcome.
Jill, we're talking about a little bit during a break about brain disorders, you know, believer, not believer, you know, how do you feel on it?
So I think it's important that, you know, clients and family members and anybody involved in the addiction field in any way understand that this is a brain disorder. You know, and we all know that many people do stigmatize this disease. Don't even believe that it's a disease. We criminalized drug addicts, you know, over 30, 50 years ago, you know, that when all of that started. And it's important to understand these are human beings and that an addict's brain functions differently than a normal person's brain. And all you have to do is Google it to find that out. I mean, it's very simple. The science is there. And, you know, I base a lot of my therapeutic approaches on the addiction science that I have researched through the National Institute of Drug Abuse with Director Dr. Nora Volkov. And, you know, she gives you all of the answers that you need. And don't we need that? You know, as recovering people coming into treatment, I want answers as to why I am the way that I am. Don't tell me I just need to stay sober. I need the science behind it. That's the way I work, you know? So it's important that people understand. People can't stop. Addicts can't stop. They want to stop. But because the drugs have altered our brain chemistry and have caused a situation where our pleasure reward system is literally setting off fireworks in our brain, right? Yes. We cannot help ourselves. So even if, you know, my lovely grandmother's in front of me pleading with me to stop, because the pleasure was so so rewarding in my brain, I will do whatever I need to do, including step over my beautiful grandmother, right, to get what I want. Not because I don't know that that's wrong. I know it's wrong, but because I feel like I have to. It's a survival mode that
it's
we go into.
It's not a choice, right?
It's not a choice, correct.
I heard stepping over grandma.
We don't suggest you try that at home.
Let's not do that. Let's not step over grandma.
I mean that happens during active addiction, right. Not now.
If you guys don't mind, when you're talking about the brain disorder and the different things, so that leads us obviously into the post-acute withdrawal syndrome is that time for that brain chemistry to heal.
That's right.
And that's where that real dangerous time is that first 2 years of recovery.
Absolutely.
So how do you deal with that with your clients?
Absolutely. So I warn them. I let them know what's going to happen. You know, today may be a really good day for you. You know, perhaps we're having a really good conversation. Maybe you're talking about, you know, your cravings and your obsessions and all of that. Tomorrow may not be so good. Things are going to go up and down. And I'm here with you through it. And let's fight this together. Just because you're getting clean and sober and the drugs aren't in you anymore does not mean life is going to stop. You're going to have some obstacles and your moods obviously are impacted because your brain has been altered, and I'm going to help you through it because I've been there, and we know what to do. Right. You know, they just need to know they're safe, right, is what I find usually works.
Yeah. And their brains are going to scream for drugs.
Of course, and that's normal.
First 6 months a year, it is normal.
It's normal, and a lot of clients I find are afraid to tell you that they're having cravings and obsessions because they feel like something's wrong or that they're doing something wrong. I'm here to tell you, you're doing everything right if you're talking about it.
Right.
And that's how you work through it. A craving has a life and it dies after a while, you know, as long as you're talking about it. If you're ruminating about it in your mind, you make it worse. Yeah. But put it out there and before you know it, it's gone.
Yeah.
Right?
I read some research about 10 years ago about if you interrupt a negative thought, a craving, uh-huh. for 10 minutes by talking to somebody, calling somebody, taking a walk, in 10 minutes that craving will go away. Now, it may come back 2 minutes mm-hmm. later, to half hour later, but they say it needs about 10 minutes of distraction to get your brain off of that thought.
Absolutely, you know, absolutely so. Correct. I had a friend of mine that would tell a story about how he would set his microwave for 10 to 15 yeah. minutes, and he knew when the microwave went off, beep, yeah. beep, beep, it was over, and yes. he could go on with his life. I mean, that sounds a little unsafe to me. You should have some yeah. food in there with it, right, you yeah. know.
That's
but,
a little crazy.
He just ate
works.
A lot of popcorn.
That's totally a little crazy.
Yeah, he did, yeah.
Make some popcorn, yeah.
But yeah. whatever works, yeah. right?
Yes, sure. And when an addict's in that craving, they don't realize that all I have to do is wait this out.
Correct.
In a few minutes, it doesn't feel like they're going to be okay.
Well, of course, yes. because for an addict, we're so used to that instant gratification. I know that if I hustle, I know if I do this and do this and do this and end up here, I'll be able to get relief for this uncomfortable feeling. I don't know that there's any other alternative until someone shows me and tells me that. Right.
And again, they're not going to believe that on face value many times, and mm-hmm. they've got to try it. When it works for themselves, then yeah. they get the proof. But listening to people, you know, yeah. you could have the greatest advice in the world. It doesn't matter.
Right. And you know what? I also find in those types of situations, if they're not really hearing you, go to the next level. You know, I'm a big fan of gestalt therapy. I'm a big fan of release of energy and frustrating, right, to get that emotion out. Because I know there's going to be relief at the end.
Right.
So I'll grab a punching bag, right?
Yeah.
And safely, you know, have them yeah. hit, you know, the bag right. or whatever yeah. it is, or scream. Yeah. We, right. you know, I do a lot of scream therapy with right. clients yeah. and things yeah. like this. So that
scream
they can,
therapy.
Yes.
Describe what that is.
Oh, well, we curse and Whoa. A lot and yes, and
primal
I
primal scream is
primal
the
scream. That, very, yes. very yes, and I'll have them go around the room and release their anger. You know, of course, we make yes. sure that the clientele is okay with it, but they usually get a lot out of it, and they feel fantastic afterwards, and they're certainly not having a craving.
Yeah. In the wow. late 80s, early 90s, they had groups, therapy groups. You would go to 10, 15, 20 people and scream for an hour and a half.
Mm-hmm. It works.
And after people say, I feel better, I feel relief.
Yeah, you do. You know, you feel relief.
Along with all those endorphins that mm-hmm. you've flushed.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Yeah.
Pardo, you want to scream a little bit?
I think we should all enjoy some scream therapy right now.
Oh, let's all do a little scream. Let's
all I don't know if the meter can handle it.
Well, that's I don't know what kind of scream that was. That's a different kind of therapy there, Scott.
So what other tools do you utilize in your treatment approach that you found to be effective?
So what I find to be effective, I'm typically called the psychotherapist, and I don't mean as a psychotherapist. I mean like the psychotherapist
right.
because I'm really badass. I'm really intense. I'm really in your face. And I'll tell you what time it is. You know what I mean? Because I feel like an addict needs to hear the truth. Now, at the same time, there's this whole thing about building rapport, which I also think is very important.
Right. Yes.
But I feel that clients respond to the truth. You know, addicts can handle it. They can handle it if you're letting them know, hey, you're full of BS right now and you know it. You know, they want to hear that somebody gets it. They want to hear that somebody's onto them a little bit sometimes. Right. And they start to respect you as a result. But of course, you want them to know that you care. And I really think it just has to do with the individual working with the client. They can feel whether you care or not. And for some reason, they know. They can feel it in my energy that, you know, I've been there. I do self-disclose that I'm in recovery because it's helpful. And it gets me somewhere. And, you know, I'm going to tell you the truth. And I'm going to be honest with you. I'm going to be firm with you. And they typically like that approach. One client called me a Sour Patch therapist. She's like, God, you really bite. And then I love you. You're super sweet, you know? And I said, yeah, well, that's what it is. Yeah.
Tell us more about your personal journey, how you got here.
Sure. So growing up, you know, in a household in New Jersey, I mean, I grew up in a lovely middle-class home. I am not going to sit here and tell you that I had this major traumatic situation. I did not. My parents provided everything for us. They were wonderful to us. They set boundaries. You know, we had consequences for our behavior. We were not spoiled. You know, I mean, they did everything right, you know. But in my personal situation, what I found for me is, you know, I was a middle child. I had an older sister and a younger brother, and I always kind of just felt different. You know, they talk about that middle child syndrome, if you will. But for me, it was just addiction. You know, right. It was always in me. Mm-hmm. I always felt inadequate.
Right.
I always felt different. I was always comparing myself to everyone. And I always had a lot of anxiety. I worried about things that I shouldn't have been worried about at such a young age. And I was kind of controlled by my thoughts, you know, for most of my life. And I still struggle with that to this day. The drugs that I discovered, and I was, what you would call like a garbage can. I mean, I did everything that I could get my hands on just to escape my mind. And it was kind of like this moment of, okay, like, this is exactly what I've always been waiting for. This is the answer, you know, when I started abusing chemicals. And I thought I was functioning better. I thought it made everything better. And very quickly, that turned into a horrible situation to the point where, you know, my second year in college was really when it got really bad. I was in my apartment, depressed, never leaving the apartment. And I mean, my parents had to kind of intervene to get me out of that situation, smoking pot every day, you know, just being really bad to myself and not seeing any light at the end of the tunnel and not really knowing where I belonged, you know. And I came home, I had lost a couple of jobs due to my addiction, one of which that I loved. You know, I worked at a golf club that Trump actually bought 10 years ago or so. But I worked there, it was a great job, and I was there for 4 or 5 years. I worked my way up the ladder, which I typically do in a lot of, you know, my experience. And I was fired for, you know, buying pills off of one of the busboys. I was caught on surveillance, you know. I mean, it was horrible. I mean, talk about a fall from grace. For me, at the time, that was the end. And I had to lie about it. And it was just one lie after another. It was terrible. And one day, I came home from one of the jobs that I was working. My Italian father, you know, was in the kitchen. My mom is in the kitchen. We have like a bar kind of like around our kitchen. My mom was over here. My dad was over here. He dumped out my purse because, you know, as an addict lady, everything's in our purse. And all of my stuff and baggies went everywhere, you know, and I got a nice hit upside the head. And I looked over after I got a little hit upside the head and I saw my mother just sobbing uncontrollably on the counter in the kitchen. I never saw that before. Even to this day, just talking about it, I can see her. And I don't know what happened, but that moment changed everything for me. I said to myself, I will never put her through this again. And they asked me if I needed help, and I said yes. It was almost like something came over me. I just said, yes, I'm ready. They got me into treatment the next day. It was supposed to be a 30-day stay, and I'm here 9.5 years later.
Yes.
So, you know, it worked. Yeah.
Good for you.
Yeah. I'm very fortunate. I had parents that really did something. They did not take any crap. You were going to get help. This was the first and only time, and you are not welcome back unless you do the right thing. So I was blessed with that. Yeah.
So mm-hmm. strong boundaries on your parents' part.
Yeah, absolutely.
Really helps the addict so much.
Oh, my God. Yeah. Yes.
The parents can help
it's,
or destroy.
And you know what it is, Dr. Joe? It's also the parents realizing that they do have a problem.
Yes.
And they need to treat it.
Yes.
Yeah.
Instead of being in denial.
Absolutely.
Hoping it'll go away. Hopefully it's a phase Johnny's going through.
Yes.
You know.
And stop the enablement.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
You need to.
Yeah.
Yes.
Go to an Al-Anon, go to an Ar-Anon, pick up the phone, call an 800 number, get some. Don't try to do this yourself. Mm-hmm. A lot of parents think they want to handle it within the family because of the shame and guilt, so we'll deal with it. Well, Johnny is going to run you ragged, or Jill, and she's going to steal from you and lie, and they're going to take you to school as far as the school of hard knocks, and all of a sudden the parents are the victims.
That's right. That's right. And if there's one thing that I can say to the parents, do not take them home. Do not take them home.
They don't need to come home, correct?
They don't need to come home. The whole point is for them to grow up and go out. Not it is not them. To come home, I implore you. Do not promise your children, if you complete 30 days, you can come home. That is where this started, and it will start again. They need to struggle. They need to learn on their own what to do.
And I think that's the parents' codependency need to have their child back all better, out of treatment, and we go back to the family we used to be.
That's right.
And that's not like that.
It's not the
case. It's not the fairy tale.
No. You know, you could be supportive, but also have the boundaries. Yeah. Not when, you know, you have a client that comes in the first week of treatment, you know, it's a change, they're starting to feel different. They pick up the phone, hey, Mom, I need a plane ticket. I want to go home.
Right.
I'm better.
Yeah. Right.
You're not better.
You're not better.
It's not the way it works.
Yes.
Absolutely.
You don't flick on the switch and everything's good. Mm-hmm. Just doesn't work that way.
Mm-hmm.
They would like you to be better. They hope you're better. They might even believe you. Yeah.
They know you're safe. You're in a good place. You're getting something out of the program.
Yeah.
Relax.
Relax. And understand that a lot of your response to your children and to the treatment professionals is typically guilt motivated. And what I mean is, you feel bad. We know. You feel bad about what's happened with your child. We know that.
And you feel responsible. Absolutely.
But it's nobody's fault. And you know what? If it is your fault, you got to go talk to somebody.
Right. That's right.
That this is for your loved one. Right. It's not about anything else.
Well,
right?
What we do here, Jill, is we do a lot of family sessions.
Beautiful.
And we find that, you know, the problem isn't just their child or spouse or loved one. Mm-hmm. It's everyone.
Yes.
Because everyone's affected.
Right.
So you're not going to send Johnny to treatment for 30 or 60 days, have him come back home, and the family's fine.
That's right.
Everyone has to adapt. Right. And what we do here at TPA is we do weekly sessions with the family, whether it's via Skype or fly-ins or you spend the weekend here. Mm-hmm. But for the long haul, it's needed.
Yes, absolutely.
That family involvement is crucial.
So important. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I agree.
Now, I would imagine after a period of time, you had that cathartic moment with your family where it's like everything kind of came together and everyone realized the right choices were made for you to be able to reach the pinnacle of being a Sour Patch psychotherapist. but for you to get there, I mean, there had to be that moment, which I think a lot of people are looking for that they're afraid will never come. Can you talk about that?
Having that moment, despair. Despair is what I think every addict needs to have in order to get where they need to be. In other words, I have to learn the hard way. I have to struggle. I have to hit a point of despair in order to work towards something better, you know? And I try to use that experience, and I believe that that experience happened so that I could share it with others, with clients in this type of environment, to pass on that you can be at the bottom of the bottom and think that there's no hope and still make it and be really good and be really successful. Yes. If I can do this, anybody can do this, because there is nobody that's harder on me than I am every single day of my life. You know, my disease tells me on the way over here, you're not worth this show. And I'm just being candid with you. Right. I'm just being real with you because this is my disease, right?
Right?
You're not worth this. You're a fraud and you know it. Well, no, I'm not. Bullshit. I've earned my stripes and I deserve to be here because there's people that need to hear this story somewhere.
That's correct.
Yeah. Does that answer your question?
Kind of, sort of, yes. I mean, I was also looking for that moment where maybe you and your family realized the path you chose was correct. That comes at a certain point.
Yes.
Not always right away, but it takes a little time.
Takes a little bit of time. You mean
where
as
they feel
far
good
as
about the choice they made, you feel good about it too.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Oh, my parents were, I think, very hesitant about me, of course, being in Florida and staying in Florida. You know, they struggled as far as, you know, is this the right thing to do? She's all by herself. You know, what happens next? But as I kind of proved myself, and this is one of those things that our clients have to do, right? You have to earn trust. You have to work towards something, and you start to make it clear to your family that you can do this. And after a while, my mom said she just stopped worrying about me, which was a first. I was amazed by that. You know, she said to me at one point, I don't worry about you. Oh, what a relief that was for her.
For both of you, right?
Yeah, yes. Yeah, but mostly for her, yeah. You know, because yeah. She was always just terrified of what I was up to, you know. Yes. So it's a great gift to be able to give her, yeah.
That's awesome.
All right, remember, we are taking questions via our comment section on Facebook, so please write in. We're going to take a short break, and we'll be right back.
Welcome to Treatment Partners of America.
For me, seeing a client enter and then go through the whole program and graduate is the most rewarding feeling one could ever have.
Clients need physical, social, spiritual, mental, and intellectual knowledge.
I get to see the miracle and the change within a client from the time that they come in till the time they discharge.
We are Treatment Partners of America.
Your partner in recovery.
And we're back here at Sober Smash Live with King Scott and Dr. Joe and our special guest, Jill Stellacio. Gentlemen. Scream therapy.
Scream therapy coming at you.
Yes, it works.
Jill, your cousin Mark just wrote in and said he's very proud of you.
Oh, my Mark. I love Mark.
Thanks, Mark.
Thank you, Mark. Yeah, we have a very special connection, he and I, actually.
That's nice.
Oh, that's nice.
Just a quiet moment of love here.
Yeah, there is. That's nice.
Let's go scream some more.
No more screaming.
No more screaming.
let's sober smash Mark. Yeah. Mark, you've been sober smashed.
He'll love that.
So what are your future plans in the industry? Tell us what you have in the future coming up.
Okay. So I got a lot of things. You know, I've been in the addiction field for quite some time, and I feel like I've gained a lot of experience working with all types of different, you know, populations of individuals. And I've always been into the forensic psychology, you know, field. So I'm currently studying at Nova Southeastern for my graduate degree.
Congratulations.
In forensic psych. Yeah, thank you.
Good deal.
Thanks. Yeah. You know, so that's a 2-year program. We're going to see where that takes me. Mm-hmm. I've always wanted to work with the, you know, criminal justice system and all that good stuff and see what's going on in the minds there. Yeah.
I think finally criminal justice and law enforcement is finally realizing they're crying uncle and saying, we can't do this.
Yeah.
We don't have enough jails. We don't have enough prisons. Mm. We can't do this addiction thing. Mm-hmm. And for the first time in my 32-year career, I see law enforcement reaching out.
32 years? How old are you? God.
62. Ran my first marathon last Sunday.
Hey.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Yeah. So we talk about having goals. So you're in school. I found what helps me in my life is to have goals, to complete this, to
complete this,
to plan things that you don't think are obtainable, and yet you attain them. Right. And that's what makes me feel alive and know that I'm living a fulfilled life. You know?
Yeah, you have to have that sense of achievement, to get anywhere. Even just getting out during the day and just enjoying the day is a wonderful thing to do. You know, because sitting alone with our thoughts, I mean, for me, is just not the neighborhood I want to be in.
An addict alone is in bad company.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Yeah.
Yes.
And it's important to celebrate those achievements, especially for addicts. You know, you have to praise yourself a little bit. Not too much, but give yourself credit where it's due. Yeah.
That's right. Yeah, you got to have something for yourself to believe in yourself a little bit.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So speaking about law enforcement, you know, we've been getting a lot of great cooperation from the legal system lately. judges, probation officers, all of a sudden over the past few years, they're really willing to work with us.
Yeah.
Whereas a few years ago, they wanted to punish the addict. And if you got somebody in probation, well, he better get to my office by Tuesday or I'm going to buy. You know, now all of a sudden, it's like, just send me a letter. I'll take it to the judge.
Oh, yeah.
And it's amazing. And thank God that the field is turning around and legal system's finally saying we need help. And
oh,
you know,
finally.
We're working with the New York State Bail Bondsman Association. We've had several clients in here.
I saw that.
And amazing work. These courts are giving these clients freedoms that they never had before because they're following the treatment protocol that we're prescribing here.
Yeah, it's wonderful that you guys are doing that. I saw that on your website, and I think that's a fantastic partnership that you guys have.
Yeah, absolutely.
Absolutely. And you're right. They are a whole lot more flexible, aren't they? If only they realized that when all of this kind of started, you know, that criminalizing a drug addict is not the way to go. But you know what? I mean, whatever it is, at least they're realizing it now so we can finally, you know, do something with it. Yeah.
Yes. Mm-hmm. That's great. Yeah.
That's true.
Mm-hmm.
That's true. You know, we look and see how many people have come in here through the court system now that would have been in jail.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
For, you know, even like these misdemeanor drug offense charges.
Yes.
And it is changing.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And I think there still needs to be a lot more change.
Right.
Oh, God.
Especially with the drug courts.
Yes.
Oh,
yes.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Absolutely. And I'm hoping that in some of my studies, as I move forward, we'll be able to kind of, I want to bring awareness to that in some way, shape, or form. I don't exactly know how that will kind of turn out. But, you know, it's so important. Even non-addicts, you know, the way we're treating our criminals here in the United States. I mean, we're releasing people straight from segregation out into population just to fail, you know, and it happens in the treatment facilities too, in some of them, where you're not setting up people for success. You're setting them up for relapse and for the cycle to continue. So it's so important that, you know, they get on board with us and we can work together as a team and figure out how to help just everybody. I mean, it's a domino effect. It affects everyone in the world.
So. Sure.
Sure does.
Sure. Pardo, you want to add to this?
No, I just, you know, I think it's really interesting. And I guess, that, you know, I hear a lot about you're really dedicated to like the family healing and everything. If you had to send a message out to people who just maybe haven't had any experiences with this in their lives, and unfortunately, statistics say they're going to at one point. What would you say to families who maybe haven't experienced this yet, maybe have young kids and are afraid of their future?
Mm. So don't panic. Don't freak out. This is something that has become such a huge field for a reason. There are a lot of us out there, and there are a lot of us that want to help. And there are solutions to the problem. If you're noticing that, you know, you have a child that perhaps is showing some signs of some type of mental health or addiction issues, get in touch with a therapist that has experience with those types of issues. See what the resources are out there, and let's stay ahead of the problem. Don't wait until you find paraphernalia on them. If your gut is telling you that something's wrong, something's wrong. So pick up the phone and utilize all the resources that you can. There's plenty of great places that you can go to, and great social workers or therapists that you can go to for help, you know?
Yeah.
Prevention is really where it's at right now.
That's right.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
And there's plenty of places that you can go to get that prevention.
You know, much like the disease of cancer, the new wave is early detection.
Yes.
And the earlier a client gets the treatment, the better chance they have a successful outcome.
Yeah, yeah. And talk about it. Talk about it in the family. No hush-hush, because that only causes more shame and embarrassment for everybody involved.
Right.
Put it out there. Have an honest, open communication and conversation. This is the problem. Let's talk about it. What are we going to do about it? You know, if you talk honestly with your child, they will talk honestly with you. I'm a strong believer in that.
The old stigmas aren't attached to addiction anymore. I mean, it's, you know, you're not cool in music or good in movies or even a good sports star until you've gone through at least one rehab. It seems to be more the norm today.
Right. It is.
That people who are in recovery are more enlightened and more open to life.
Yeah.
I see addicts in my everyday life, and I find them more interesting, more full of life, and better people.
It's acceptable today. That's what it is.
It really is. It's acceptable.
You know? And it happens to everyone.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Our family, your family, my next door neighbor.
Right.
Mm-hmm. It's everywhere.
That's right. Mm-hmm. That's
so
right.
Open up your eyes.
Yes.
Absolutely.
That's it.
Yeah. Absolutely.
My family got in line four times, but hey, you know.
Yeah. Fourth time's a charm.
And if anyone out there has any questions or needs to get in touch with us and you do need help, please message us. We will get you help right away.
Right.
I want to thank Jill for being our guest today.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Dr. Joe.
Thank you.
Pardo.
Thank you, Jill.
Producer Jay, Engineer D, thank you. We'll see everybody soon.
Goodbye.